Thanksgiving Sunday. Am I on now? Testing 1, 2. It says I'm on. Okay. How's everybody doing?
Good.
Great.
Oh my goodness. Well, happy Thanksgiving.
Same to you.
It's good to see everybody. It's been one of those weeks. So why should Sunday morning be any different? I want to read Psalm 100 this morning. That's what I'll be preaching from when the message comes around in the service. But it's a great passage of scripture as it relates to giving thanks and praise. Psalm 100 says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations." This should not just be the only Sunday of the year that we think of all of the blessings that God has sent our way. But I'm going to ask you to do something this morning, because we may try something a little bit different in the middle of the message. I'm going to ask you to think of something that you are thankful for this Sunday morning, this Thanksgiving Sunday. And there's probably going to come a point in the service where I'm going to ask for some just pop-up testimonies. Not looking for anything 20, 30 minutes. Just one thing that you are thankful for this Thanksgiving Sunday. Let's have a word of prayer and we'll get right into our service. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity which is ours to gather together in your house, to sing your praises, to, Father, be fed from your word. Lord, you are an awesome God. You are amazing beyond our ability to comprehend. We thank you, Father, that you are sovereign, that you are holy, and that you are indeed a God who hears and answers prayer. Yes. We thank you, Father, that you are with us this morning. For your word tells us where two or three are gathered together in your name, you are in the midst. So, Father, our heart's desire this morning is to lift up the name of Jesus Christ, to focus our attention solely on you, and, Father, to leave this place thankful for all that you do. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want you this morning, as we sing, I want you to focus on the words. I challenge the men Thursday night at the men's Bible study not to necessarily just think about the music and going through the motions, but to concentrate on the words of the songs that you are singing this morning. And sing it to the Lord. Amen. Amen. Danny, would you come?
Thank you, Pastor. Boy, this is going to be a good Sunday morning.
Amen.
I feel it already. And you know, I don't know who did this, but thank you. Because I was thinking, we don't do this anymore. When I was young, Thanksgiving morning was incredible. The whole front of the church was filled with all kinds of things. Squash, pumpkins, cabbage, everything. Gourds, the weirdest looking gourds you've ever seen in your life, with the biggest bumps on them. It was incredible. Cabbage?
Cabbage?
Yes. Not our cabbage bumps. Just gourds. I didn't mean gourd. No, it's okay.
We got a gourd.
Just a bunch of, well, I just got But, you know, it was exciting as a kid, because my dad would take us out in the bush on Saturday, and we'd have to find just the right red maple leaves. And we would cut branches about yay long, and they all had to be perfectly red. And then he had a little thing.
thing that he put in the window that he had made in each one of the windows, and the branches of Gwyn and Bay across like that. All these things are memories. That it seems like we're too busy today to make memories. So thank you. I appreciate that. That is just wonderful to have just a token memory of Thanksgiving and be so thankful for everything God has blessed us with. We just take everything for granted. So let's stand and sing like the pastor has said, and I've always thought exactly the same thing. Apply the words to your heart that you're singing. And you're singing them unto the Lord. Let's stand and sing, "We Have Come to His House."
Yesterday, and they got together with family via the computer. It's not quite the same, but we as a church family want to wish them a very happy anniversary. All right. Council times for Awana are online. Ruth Geyer, our commander, wanted us to make sure you were aware. If you would like to be a part of that and be able to catch it online, that you can sign up or subscribe, Brenda, in the name of the...
Let me know and I will send them.
Yeah, let Brenda know. She'll send you a link so that you can watch the videos. Ruth and Sandy Flexhog are putting together videos for each week for the Council Times, and they've put a lot of effort in. And they're here in the building by themselves, unsupervised. So we have seen glimpses of different offices, including my own, being used in the videos. So I'll start locking my office right shortly. But you can certainly be a part of that and keep up with what's going on with our Awana program. Samaritan's Purse, there are a few Christmas child boxes at the back as you are preparing to leave, but the majority of them will be here next week. And they have to be returned, I believe, by November the 15th, so you have just about a month. But that is an important ministry that we can be a part of. So we encourage you to take a box or two, and there is no sign-up sheet this year, so we are trusting you to bring that box back fully loaded and ready to send to a child in a third world country. Adult youth Bible classes will be at 10 o'clock right after the 9 o'clock service, and we encourage you to be a part of that. There are two classes taking place right now. There is Glenn Braun's class, which is studying the book of Colossians, and there is David Lackey's class, which is our discipleship class. Men's breakfast, that early morning manna is on Tuesday mornings at 7 o'clock. We've begun that again, and we are restricted now to six at a table. So if you want to sit at the big table, you got to be there early, all right? Otherwise, you'll be relegated to the cast-offs table, all right? 7 o'clock Tuesday morning. South Niagara Life Ministries, Kathy Washburn would like to remind everyone, if you have pledged to support her in her walk, if you could please talk to her and make sure that you pay your pledges as soon as possible. Wednesday nights, we are in the book of Ephesians. 7 o'clock every Wednesday night. We just began the introduction this last Wednesday, and we are going to be continuing that for the foreseeable future. And the theme of that is who we are in Christ. And I believe that it's a very important study for the day and age in which we live. And we encourage you to be here and be a part of that on Wednesday nights, or catch us online if you will. Next Sunday morning, we are beginning a series of messages through the book of Revelation. As I've been saying, it's not a verse-by-verse exposition. We will be hitting the highlights, but we'll be talking about prophetic events that are in the near future. And we encourage you to be a part of that and be here for those messages. Overcomers is coming up Tuesday, October the 20th, and we will be having music and message by Gideon Levitam. Did I say that correctly? Gideon Levitam, he's been with us before. He is a Jewish believer, and he ministers to a congregation in Niagara-on-the-Lake. But he will be with us via Zoom. So you pray for us, because this will be the first Zoom meeting that we have tried. So he'll be on the screen and with us virtually on the 20th of October. There will be a movie night for our youth, October the 23rd from 6:30 to 9 here at the church, and we encourage our young people to be a part of that. There will be individually packaged snacks for you that will be available that night, so please come, bring a friend with you, 6:30 to 9 on the 23rd. And then for our entire church family, on Sunday night, November the 8th, we are going to be showing the movie Before the Wrath. There's a sign-up sheet in the hallway. Before the Wrath is a unique movie because it deals with the Galilean culture surrounding a wedding and how it relates to the rapture of the church as Christ comes to get the bride of Christ. And so we encourage you to be here, be a part of that. Please sign up so we have an idea who is coming. And we're encouraging you to bring your own snacks, and we will provide drinks. So that'll be at 6 o'clock on Sunday, the 8th of November. There is some of you may know, and I'm sorry, Horace Wall. Horace Wall and his wife were involved early on in the founding of Golden Harvest, and he has just passed away this week. And he is the father of one of our missionaries,
Carol Hartsfield.
All right. So if you can remember Carol and Victor and their entire family in prayer during this time of loss, it would be appreciated. All right, the offering baskets are in the hallway on the pillars as you're leaving. If you would like to leave your offering in there, that would be great. Danny, would you come?
You know, I love how the Lord works. Because as I was going over these songs last night, I thought, you know, the pastor should stand up and ask for people to give a testimony of the blessings that they've received. And lo and behold, he's going to give it during his message. So are we going to stand up and sing, "Count Your Many Blessings," and make sure you have your testimony ready? Thank you.
for Thanksgiving weekend, and appreciate the fact that she is able to help us out with special music while she's home. Take your Bibles and turn back with me to the book of Psalms, Psalm 100. I've been trying to figure out exactly when I'm going to do this testimony time, and I think I'm going to do it right now. And I'll start. But because I'm the pastor, I'll talk longer than I expect you to. I've been thinking throughout the week, and every year we do this, right? Every year as it approaches Thanksgiving, we begin to contemplate and think about the things that we're grateful for. And this week, as the week has gone on, there's been a lot that has crossed my mind. I am thankful for this church. I am thankful for a church that seeks to love God and follow Him. I'm thankful as a pastor for a board of deacons that are a joy and a pleasure to work with. I'm thankful for people in our congregation who continuously uphold my wife and I in prayer. I am thankful that my wife is doing better. She has had a rough week. For some of you that don't know, she's spent a couple of nights in Emerge and with some serious blood pressure problems. She's doing better, and I am grateful for that. I'm grateful for expressions of love and concern that you have shown. I'm grateful for people in the church that come to me and say, "Pastor, can I start this? Can I do this ministry? Can I do something along this line?" This orchestra is one such example. Gordon Bryan came to me and said, "I'd like to start an orchestra." I think that would be fine. And I know that you're enjoying them. And certainly I have comments all the time from people that are not with us in person, that are watching online, just expressing how much they enjoy our little orchestra. So I appreciate that. I'm thankful for health. I'm thankful for a country like Canada that we can live in. And no, it's not perfect. And our government has issues, but I am grateful for a country in which we have freedom and we are able to gather as believers and proclaim the Word of God. And so I'd like to hear from you. How many of you have something that you're thankful for? We don't have time to bring the microphone around to you, and besides, it's not healthy to do that. So I'm just going to ask you to stand up. Pop it off.
I'm thankful for Jesus is coming back very soon.
Amen. Art.
Well, you've taken the testimony from me. I was going to say that everything you're saying pretty near, but after being here for 25 years, I know Brenda was just a little wee girl. But anyway, I'm grateful for the people that have been here, the people that have supported me, not just part way, but supported me all the way. And I'm grateful for that. I'm just grateful for church. I'm grateful for that song this morning, or that piece that played this morning. Cassie, is it?
It's Cassie.
Cassie did a wonderful job on that. And that really blessed my heart.
Amen. Amen. Somebody else, don't be shy. Huh?
I thank you for Danny. I was a little down this morning, and how his enthusiasm just lifted my spirit.
Amen.
For my other brothers and sisters in this church, I just thank you for each and every one of you.
Amen.
I am thankful for my family, my best friend, and for my guinea pig.
Amen. All right, that's awesome. That's awesome. Muriel.
I'm thankful for family, children, and grandchildren.
Amen. Grandchildren especially.
That's
amen. Davey.
I'm thankful for my wife.
Amen.
Going through this time.
the operation. It's taught me how much she does for me.
Yeah.
And I'm so blessed for my family as they've taken over and we haven't had to make a meal. We are so blessed.
Amen. Amen. We are so blessed. Brenda.
I'm very thankful for this church as well, but especially the congregation. There's such wonderful God-fearing, God-loving people. I'm very appreciative also of you and Marlene, and we hope that she is on the mend.
Thank you.
Georgia. I'm very thankful for this wonderful family speaking here.
Amen. Anybody else? Ken.
I just want to thank God for this church. It's a wonderful church, all the people in it, for the music, the fact that we can be together, and the fact that I've had health issues, because God can use it to reach health workers for the Lord.
Absolutely, absolutely. You've probably witnessed more paramedics than I have, and I'm the chaplain for the EMS. All right, I thought I saw somebody else kind of acting like they were going to stand. All right, I'm thankful for the number of young adults and young people that are in the 9 o'clock service. Amen. For you folks that are watching at home, this place is pretty much packed. There's very few empty chairs, and that is a blessing. When we started the two services on the Sunday morning, the 9 o'clock was a little bit skimpy, and the 11 o'clock was the service that was full. it's switched. 9 o'clock now is the one we're going to start taking reservations for soon. So we are so grateful for that. Psalm 100. Grateful, thankful, blessed. I hope you are today. I hope you understand what a blessing it is to be able to live in this country, to be able to come to a church service and worship God. And the poorest of us in this building today are rich by standards across the globe. And so we are truly a blessed people. Let me read it. I know I read this before, but let me read it again. Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Father, I pray this morning as we come to the Word of God that you may indeed speak to our hearts. Father, help us to understand and be mindful of all of the blessings that you send our way. Or we are not deserving of even half of what you give us. But Lord, you are a merciful, compassionate, and gracious God. And so we thank you for that. We thank you for the Word of God and for this passage. I pray that you may help us as we spend but a few moments in it, that we may understand what we should be as your people. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Max Lucado tells about living as an American in Brazil. And one day as he was walking along the street on his way to the university that he was teaching classes at, he felt a tug on his pant leg. Turning around, he saw a little boy about 5 or 6 years old with dark, beady eyes and a dirty little face. The little boy looked up at the big American and said, "Bread, sir." He was a little beggar boy, and Lucado said, "There are always little beggar boys in the streets of Brazil. Usually I turn away from them because there are so many and you can't feed them all. But there was something so compelling about this little boy that I couldn't turn away. So taking his hand, I said, 'Come with me,' and I took him to a coffee shop. Max told the owner, 'I'll have a cup of coffee and give the boy a piece of pastry, whatever he wants.' And since the coffee counter was at the end of the store, Max walked on and got a cup of coffee, forgetting about the little boy, because the beggar boys usually get the bread and then run back into the street and disappear. But this one didn't. After he'd gotten his pastry, he went over to the big American and just stood there until Lucado felt his staring eyes. Lucado said, 'I turned and looked at him. Standing up, his eyes just about hit my belt buckle. And then slowly his eyes came up until they met mine. The little boy holding his pastry in one hand looked up and said, 'Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.' Lucado said, 'I was so touched by the boy's thanks that I would have bought him the entire store. I sat there for another 30 minutes, late for my class, just thinking about that little beggar boy who came back and said, thank you.'" So often we get so busy in our lives that we forget how blessed we are. I watched a little clip on the news this week, and they were talking about a gentleman that was an immigrant, and I'm not sure if it was in Canada or the United States, but he had immigrated to North America, and he was working as an Uber driver. And he had struggled for some time since he moved here because he wasn't making meaningful connections. He wasn't getting to know people. And so he was getting depressed and discouraged, and finally he thought to himself, I've got to stop this. I've got to snap out of it. And so he began to do little tiny videos just talking about the blessings that he had in his life. He's now an internet sensation. He has thousands of followers on the social media platforms that he's on. And he just does little videos each day. Even as he's driving his Uber, he does little videos just talking about the blessings and the things he's thankful for. We often get into the other rut, don't we? It's so easy for us to get into the rut where we begin to feel sorry for ourselves. That we are victims of circumstances, and life hasn't treated us fairly, and there are so many things going on in my life right now that just aren't right and aren't fair. But I want us today to really focus on what the psalmist says here. Because as he writes this, he, I'm sure, has issues in his own life. He has things that he is struggling with, problems that he can't control. And yet he says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Then he says in verse 3, know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. And because of that fact, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. This last Thursday night, the ladies, I believe, in their ladies' Bible study were dealing with worship. Am I right? And the men, we were dealing with prayer and worship. And we were discussing what composes worship and what worship really is. Worship is the ascribing of worth to God. It is being thankful. It is expressing that by word and deed. And so when we gather together for a worship service, it's easy for us to check out mentally, right? And I know that there are some, even this morning in the service, as I stood up to preach, you checked out, right? Your eyes are open, for the most part. Colin, I can't even see you. Your eyes are open, but there's a blank stare. But I want you this morning to stay focused as much as you possibly can. Because worship occurs in every aspect of the service. The singing, obviously, is worship. The giving is worship. Somebody said Thursday night that even testimonies can be worship, and we have seen that even this morning with the things that you are thankful for in your own life. The preaching of the word is worship. But we worship God because of several things. Number one, he is holy. He is an awesome, awe-inspiring, wonderful, sovereign, infinite God. He can do all things. He knows all things. He is everywhere at once. He is in this place with us this morning.
Amen.
And so we worship him because of who he is. We worship him because of what he has done. He has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to come to this sin-sick world, to leave the splendors of heaven and take upon himself the form of a servant, as Philippians chapter 2 says, and live amongst men and women a perfect life, and then to walk up Calvary's hill and be nailed to a cross to pay the penalty that I owed for my sin, so that I may have forgiveness and eternal life. Those are just a few of the reasons that we worship him. Those are just a few of the reasons that we should be thankful this morning as we gather together in this place to recognize the goodness of God. Verse 4 of Psalm 100 gives us an invitation to thanksgiving. Verse 4 says, "Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name." I've told you before of a preacher that I knew as a young man, and I believe he's gone on to glory now, but his name was Dr. Grant Rice. And he was an evangelist. He went all over North America preaching, but he was also a church planter. And Dr. Grant Rice, it didn't matter when you met him or when you talked to him, if you asked him how he was, he had one reply. His reply was consistent for the entire length of time that I knew him. You said, "Hey, Dr. Rice, how are you doing?" He'd say, "I'm rejoicing in the Lord." How's that with us? I find that convicting because it's not always that way in my life. I'm not always rejoicing in the Lord. I'm not always aware of God's intricate dealings in my life, of how God has done everything and has planned everything and superintends every circumstance that comes into our life. But yet he does. And so the psalmist gives us an invitation to enter his courts with thanksgiving. To be grateful and thankful because we are blessed. You understand that this morning? You are blessed. God has been so, so very good to each and every one of us. We are thankful for the presence of God. It is inescapable, as Psalm 139, verse 7 says, "Whither shall I go from thy spirit? Or whither shall I flee from thy presence?" Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, is with us. The Holy Spirit of God dwells within the heart and life of every believer. So we can be grateful for those things. But the psalmist goes on in verses 1 through 3 and gives us basically the how of thanksgiving. Verses 1 through 3 tell us, first of all, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. When I was policing in Woodstock, the church we were attending, the pastor of that church could not sing a note. I'm serious. It was painful to listen to him sing. And there were times where I was, he'd sit on the front row and he would just belt it out. I mean, he didn't care. And I'd be standing beside him because I had some part in the service and he'd be, it was like one note the whole time. And Pastor Steve, if you're watching online at all, I apologize. But he couldn't sing at all. But he did exactly what Psalm 100 verse 1 says. Amen. He made a joyful noise. And it was a noise. Let me tell you. As we come together in his presence, singing is an important aspect of our service. Because it draws our hearts up towards him. It removes our gaze from this world and our problems and our heartaches and our difficulties and all the things that divide us and focuses our attention on God that is beyond our ability to comprehend. The how. Make a joyful noise. In church one Sunday, there was a small child who kept turning around smiling at everyone. He wasn't gurgling, he wasn't spitting, he wasn't humming, he wasn't tearing up the hymn books. He was just turning around smiling at everyone. He wasn't even rummaging through his mother's purse. He was just smiling. Suddenly his mother jerked him around and in a staged whisper that everyone could hear, she said, "Stop grinning! You're in church." With that, she gave him a little bit of a slap on his hind side. And as the tears rolled down his cheeks, she added, "That's better." She returned to trying to concentrate on the service. I am a firm believer that coming to church ought not to be painful. Amen.
Amen.
I'm a firm believer that when we gather together as believers, that we can smile. Now, there would be those who would argue that, well, that's not very reverent. And I understand the need for reverence because we are in the presence of a holy God. But when I use my imagination and I think of the Lord Jesus Christ and his 12 disciples, I do not think for a moment that every moment they were together for those 3.5 years that they were somber and straight-faced. I kind of think that there were times of laughter, that there were times of joy, there were times where they were joking with each other and kidding each other and just having fun together. I don't think our God is a God that is straight-faced and somber. You know how I know that? Well, number one, he saved me and he called me to preach. That's a joke in itself.
Amen.
Number two, some of y'all are here this morning, and that's proof that God has a sense of humor. The how. Be joyful. Rejoice in God's goodness. Smile once in a while. It would do your face good. You know? They say it takes less muscles to smile than it does to frown. Some of y'all got strong faces. Because you're using those muscles a lot. There is joy in serving Jesus. He says, first of all, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Then he says, serve the Lord with gladness. Did you get that? Serve the Lord with gladness. First thing I want you to notice from that verse is the word serve. Right? I was just listening on the way to church this morning to a book by Francis Chan called Letters to the Church. And he was talking about the fact that the church he had built in California in Simi Valley that became a mega church started in their living room. But as the church grew and they moved from building to building and bought larger and larger property as it continued to grow, he said it was the same all the way along. There was a select group of people who were busy as one-arm paper hangers. And there were a large majority that came, sat, and went. The psalmist says, serve the Lord with gladness. Do you know what? Don't tell anybody this because everybody will want to be involved, but it is a joy and a privilege to serve Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now keep it quiet, because the 11 o'clock service, everybody's going to want to get involved now if you tell them. All right? Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing.
I have to go to church today.
Do you know what? You get to come to church.
Amen.
You get to come to God's house. And we're not perfect here. I'm the first one to admit it. We've got our issues. But we're working on Brenda, and we'll get her straightened out. We're not perfect here. Our style of worship may not be for everybody, and that's why I told the men Thursday night, don't think about the style of music, think about the words that you're singing.
Amen.
Think about the message that comes to your heart and the message that is relayed to God of how thankful and grateful we are for his goodness to us.
Amen.
Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. And then he says something that's profound, especially in this day and age. He says, know ye that the Lord, he is God. Did you get that? The Lord, he is God. First of all, he's God and I'm not. Right? He's God and I'm not. Secondly, he is God. Infinite. Holy. Supreme. Omnipresent. Omnipotent. He is everywhere at once. He is in the midst of us. He knows the thoughts of our hearts. The Lord, he is God. It is he that made us and not we ourselves. You know what that means? It's referring to the creation of our physical bodies. But it is also, I believe, applicable to the fact that wherever you are in your life, whatever degree of success you have had in your life, it is he that has made us and not we ourselves. And for that, we stop and we praise God.
Amen.
We thank him for his goodness to us. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. What an awesome thought. I'm going to have to wrap up here because you all gave so many testimonies I don't have time to preach my message. Matthew Henry, the famous biblical scholar and commentator, was once accosted by thieves and robbed. He later wrote these words in his diary. And I want you to listen close because these words are profound. He said, let me be thankful first because I was never robbed before. Second, let me be thankful because although they took my purse, they did not take my life. Third, because although they took my all, it was not much. And fourth, because it was I who was robbed, and not I who robbed. Thankfulness is a matter of perspective. It is too easy for us to look from a different angle and feel sorry for ourselves, as if we have been hard done by and victimized by life. This morning, the worst off of any of us is blessed beyond measure. And so let us be grateful. Let us be thankful because we are blessed. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this morning, for your blessings to us. Lord, forgive us for the fact that too often our thankfulness is restricted to this weekend. Help us, Father, each and every day throughout the course of the year, that we would be a people who are thankful, that recognize your hand, that recognize your blessings, and give you praise.
Yes.
We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Daniel, would you come?
Thank you, Pastor. A lot of you know this song is my favorite song. And I can't get through it most times. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Over and over, I could tell you how his faithfulness to me, unworthy me. So let's stand and sing with all our hearts.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassion.
Thank you.
Amen.
Father, thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness.
Yes.
Thank you for all that we possess in Jesus Christ.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I pray that as we leave this place today, that we may long rehearse your faithfulness and your blessings to each of us. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. God bless you.